Hello and welcome to another edition of Journalist Hangout. I'm Ayodele Uzubakun. On the program today, Presidency at Bukola Saraki engaged in war of words. PDP's factional chairman Ahmed Malkafi appeals to Ali Modu Sharif to embrace the peace. And later on the program, President Buhari furious over deaths of IDPs in Borno State. I'll be joined by Babajide Koladeo Titoju, Waheed Bakare and Mojib Jamiu to talk about these issues. The program starts in a moment. Yesterday, Presidency and the Senate President Bukola Saraki started an open war of words after Saraki and his deputy Ike Ikuremadu were arraigned for alleged forgery of the rules of the Senate chamber. Saraki was the first to fire at the presidency. He alleged that a cabal had hijacked President Buhari's government. He claimed the cabal is using Mr. President to pursue its wicked agenda. He said it will be a happy guest if the doors of jail were opened up for him. In an angry reaction, Presidency regarded his allegations as a piece of worthless fiction caused by waking up from a troubled sleep. Presidency dared Saraki to back his allegations with evidence. This exposes how badly the relationship between the executive and the legislature has become. But is there any sense in Saraki's allegation? FJ, let me start from you. Bringing it home now. Yesterday, they were arraigned. And what I want to place emphasis here, because we don't want to go to the court case proper, we want to look at the larger implication. It's like Abubakar Bukola Saraki has the support of senators and members of the House of Rep. So let's say the National Assembly is under his armpits. And the man is saying, no, there's nothing he can do. That some people, fifth columnists within the presidency, might have hijacked the presidency from Muhammadu Buhari.
In his words, he said, we now have a government within a government. That's what Saraki is saying. But then, in one breath, he said the AGF has the constitutional right to, bring to law or bring to book anybody who infringes upon the constitution. Now you're also saying in another breath that the AGF, Malami, is only using some trumped up charges with the prompting of the fifth columnists, or rather people.
Who are these people?
Do
you have any idea?
No, additional told him that
name names.
To
be explicit.
That letter is like, it was written by somebody who just woke up from the wrong side of the bed, you know.
Troubled sleep.
From a troubled sleep, or you woke up from the wrong side of the bed. But then, can Saraki go the full hog? He says he's ready to go to jail. Now, you see, this is not a matter between the presidency and the Senate, or whether the presidency or the executive arm of the government or the AGF, so to say, in question now, is infringing on the rights of the legislature. But we have this 2015 standing rules of the Senate, which was doctored by the seventh stroke eighth assembly, so that some principal officers could emerge. And it is the
what
role
do you mean by seventh stroke eighth assembly?
Well, some members of the seventh assembly who are now still members of the eighth assembly.
Okay.
But then don't forget that some of the witnesses of the federal government,
yes,
in the case against the principal officers of the Senate,
yes,
the Senate President, the Deputy Senate President, and the Clerk and the Deputy Clerk, are members of the
seventh
Assembly. One key member is Senator Babafemi Ojudu, who is now a special advisor to
political matters.
Of course, they know what the standing order or standing rule.
Even the custodian of that rule, the chairman, that's Itai Nank.
Itai Nank.
He's not the special advisor.
So they know what they are talking about. There is a thin line there. That was altered. So to pave way for the emergence of an opposition member to hold a principal position like that of the deputy
Senate
president, which is an aberration. In normal
because since 1999 it's unprecedented.
Let's not go into this.
Yeah, we can't go to that because that case is in court. But then, it is unsavory for Saraki to draw a battle line with the executive arm of government. It's a battle he can't win, because in a federation like ours in Africa, is the kind of powers that sits within the presidency. Even from asking for your tax papers, you can be liable just on taxation alone. So,
MJ, I'll come back to
now,
you.
Now, okay. Sorry, but don't forget that he has this issue with the Code of Conduct Tribunal.
Yes.
And now there's this forgery case. This is a criminal case. By the Attorney General of the Federation.
Wahid, when you look at it, and a lot of people will say that we have high inflation rates, all is not well with our economy, there are several other things that the presidency, you know, is meant to, you know, make like a priority. That if Saraki has been facing the CCT, that this is just like open declaration of war. And the sentiment out there, because the National Assembly members are saying that this is a coup against an independent arm of the government. What do you read between the lines? The implication of this seeming battle?
Well, there's no doubt about it that we are facing a hard time in Nigeria now. One would expect the president, you know, to concentrate on certain things. But that is not to say that if it is established that a crime has been committed by whoever, we should not leave it under the pretext that Nigeria is going through a lot of hardship now. Now, don't forget the fact that before they took them to court, you know, this is a fallout of how Saraki emerged as the Senate president. You know, the Lawan group, they wrote a petition to the police that we have it on good authority that they actually doctored the standing order rule.
He said it in his letter yesterday that why is the president having the kind of hangover over a peer group within something that has happened within
that cannot be true because of the fact that forgery, as we all know, is a criminal offense and it is punishable by 14 years imprisonment. That is if you have been charged under the criminal code. You know, that is if you have been charged under the federal government law, or like in the state. You know, it varies from state to state. So it is a criminal offense. For him to now, the issue of sentiment cannot come in now. It's quite unfortunate that the Senate president is facing two battles. But that is not to say that we should look the other way, under the pretext that, oh, we have so many hardship, there is hardship in the country now. Why can't the president concentrate on that? Are we now going to say if crimes have been committed, the president should not do anything about it, or the federal government should not do anything about it? Some people wrote a petition to the police, and police carry out their investigation. Whether the allegations are true or not is not in the domain of the court to decide.
I didn't expect.
And even if the lower court decided, wherever the pendulum swings in the lower court, there is still right of appeal up to the Supreme Court.
Okay, Jide, the vibes I'm getting that you are not in charge. That's what Saraki said in the letter, that I'm ready for jail, that I'm ready to go to jail. And looking at this critically,
is it really ready, Jide?
Is it politically expedient for the federal government to be prosecuting Abubakar Saraki, the Senate president,
and the deputy senator?
And the deputy said, president.
Who was that portion to court?
Yes.
Is it
politically expedient?
it depends on your definition of political expediency.
Of course.
Well, you see, the reality is, Saraki knows that nobody has hijacked the president. The president can only hijack himself. He knows that nobody, all those things that he attributed to other people, is actually the president that he was referring to. He ought to have shown so much courage to say, look,
to go the whole log.
You, this Fulani man from Katsina, you are the one putting me in all this, and I'm directing my vibes, of course, using your language. I'm directing my vibes at you. I know it's you. It's no other person. Malami may be the one going to court. I know it's you that is angry with me. Honestly, if you had done that, I would have given him to Ali that, yes, this man has shown courage. You know where your problem is coming from, and you are not afraid to face that person. Look, you can't convince me. Everybody knows Buhari. Even Obasanjo in his book said Buhari is stubborn. To now tell us that some individuals will find it easy to hijack him and be dragging him by his nose and be telling him, no, put Saraki, take Saraki to court. No, take this one to court. Oh, go after Nenadi Usman. She's too fine. Oh, go after Ayozuba. Occasionally, he wears a black suit. You know, that is not the issue. He knows that it is the president that is his main
problem.
And just like one of our viewers tweeted, if the president is that easy to hijack, why is Saraki waiting to hijack the president himself? Because you can't tell me that is that Adamawa man who is the secretary to the government of the federation, Babashir David Lawa, that has hijacked the man. No. On this issue, we all know where this whole problem began. If you had shown respect to the party, especially that letter that Marafa kept saying that day, read this letter. We have a correspondence from our party. You chose to drag your party in the mud. You said, no, you will not read this. If he had done, why are they not harassing
Speaker
Dogara now? Why is Dogara? Why is Dogara? Why does he have peace now? We all know that Dogara has peace.
Yes.
Dogara had audience with the president before Saraki, but you chose to treat your own party leaders like a sweet rap on the floor, and then you do not expect a backlash. In politics, you should expect that when you treat a powerful, maybe a political godfather, you treat him with disrespect, he will wait for you. Because they hardly forgive themselves in politics.
But Jide, is this not the of Mr. President? From day one, Mr. President stood aloof, saying that I will allow the National Assembly to choose whoever they want, that I can work with anybody. Why didn't the president indicate his interest that, look, I have a particular candidate?
We can say that one is water under the bridge now. We can keep saying that, but I'm giving you the example of a Dogara. Dogara is a younger person to Saraki. Saraki is older than him. Dogara chose the path of wisdom. He too fought them initially, didn't want to agree. Reluctantly, he took the list.
Yeah.
You know? And he decided to please the party by giving those people position. Remember, the APC said, yes, we agree that this election are taking place.
Yeah.
The party officially announced that it was respecting the wish of the Senate by having that leadership.
Yeah.
I remember clearly that the party said, yes, we are accepting that, yes,
the Senate. The deputy.
Yes. Yeah. All they wanted this Ilorin man to do was just say, okay, this principal officer, give them. In politics, if you adopt the winner takes all method, you will lose out. Politics is a give and take thing. If you have a political leader who wants to corner all positions, it is his foot soldiers that will mess him up on election day.
Don't forget that it's not, he might have gone into pact, or he went into pact with the People's Democratic Party, and he might have promised them these positions.
No.
Can they say
you are not just old? Let me respond to you. See where you made the mistake. He promised them the position of the vice
deputy president.
That was okay for them. They got that, and they are extremely happy. It's a Nigerian record that a party that is not in power produced a deputy senate president. They got him, they got that man into that position, and they were happy. We are talking about principal, other principal officers,
majority leader,
and the rest of them.
Majority leader.
All of them. So, how many of those ones that you are talking about are even PDP members?
Yeah.
He's no. only a PDP member, so your alibi for him does not hold water. So the what he has done to invite opprobrium for himself is what we can see clearly. No, see, I will never use big grammar like that.
We are big enough.
We are big enough. How now?
The political jingoism.
So the thing is, he should have given them those positions. Dogara bought peace for himself. They almost slaughtered him and Lasso now. In fact, Lasso was seen more like a political pariah in
Australia. Honestly.
But in the end, now nobody talks about Lasso again.
He has gone
because Dogara bought peace. For him. He bought peace. He went, he said, okay. And he fought them for weeks. Weeks upon weeks. He didn't want Gbadabi Amila now. But in the end, he succumbed. And today, Dogara is living in peace with the party leaders.
In spite of the fact that
a party
is presiding over a chamber that is diversified 360.
You know where Dogara now did? In order to appease the PDP people, Dogara now went and gave them choice.
Committee chairmanship.
You know? And nobody is talking about that because the only request that the party leadership made to him, this principal officer has given them, he did that. No, nobody is talking. He has peace. The man who chose not to toe that line, who arrogantly felt, look, I'm the senate president, I can do what I like, is the one who has these issues now. I do not subscribe to persecuting people. And honestly, if Saraki would win these cases against him, because my suspicion is that they won't even stop at these two. If he will win these cases, I will congratulate him publicly on this program. I'll congratulate him. But this is where the problem, he created the problem for himself. And he should realize it and not just be abusing people, because he's dragging himself in the mud. Look at someone like Adesina abusing our Senate president.
Yeah.
Although I quarrel with that, additional language was intemperate.
No, but then, no, he can't allow himself. I mean, he can't allow a Senate president to use that kind of language on the presidency, and he will keep quiet.
Because look, it is, you see, he represents the president.
Yeah.
Everything that about around the president connotes respect, connotes decency
and civility.
Civility. Once you go to the extent of saying somebody staggered out of sleep to make a statement, it is bad enough. That is the thing. I don't want him, because when in Nigeria, history has a way of repeating itself. When what's his
Ruben.
Name? Ruben Abati replied Obasanjo the other day and took Obasanjo to the cleaners. People were saying no, it was wrong.
It's and
they,
your mouth.
In fact, they attacked his boss instead of the man who wrote the letter that you told him to do this. That's the way I see it. Buhari is a repository of respect in Nigeria. We can't have a spokesman for the president who will be talking like Ofonagoro or Chukwumerijie of the military era.
But Jide, no, I disagree. Okay. I disagree with Jide.
Okay.
The Senate president is the number three citizen of Nigeria. For him to use those kind of languages, I mean, we all know.
Did he say the president staggered out of?
Who was he directing those?
That is what is called proportionate aggression.
No, you see, this one is also proportionate response.
No, what Adesina has done.
Adesina was even trying to help him. As he was leaving the country, he was trapping it.
See, when you say that somebody staggered out of sleep, is a euphemism for saying that he was drunk. You must understand.
And the president said president is a Muslim.
And we are fasting. We are fasting. We are fasting. We are fasting.
He's also fasting.
So the situation is very bad.
In the spirit of the Ramadan mode.
Mojid, what I'm saying to you that you know is that when we look at those exchanges, you see clearly that it was a case of disproportionate aggression. He abused the man, he abused as any president too much. And I don't think it's right. The man is facing the heat. He's facing, if you are in that position, will you fold your arms, will not talk?
But then he could have issued a statement.
Did they expect him to not complain that he's been put on trial?
My own here now is that. Our Senate President number 3 man is going from one dock to the other.
Another.
I don't know. Maybe it's only in Nigeria, but in other climes, is either he's being persecuted or he will step aside to say, let me finish with these cases. If I'm vindicated at the end of the day, better. But yesterday, when I saw that picture, our correspondent in Abuja, Sumner Sambo, had a very, very clear picture of our Senate President, Deputy Senate President,
the four of them in that dock. Yeah.
And I felt, I don't know.
You see, Jide, in Sina climes, you expect that the Senate President will put national interests first over and above personal interest. You are in the dock for the CCT trial. They wrote accused in the Code of Conduct Tribunal. It was boldly written, accused. There was there, looking like a mouse a rain-beaten mouse in a trap. He left that.
You're abusing the man again.
He came. No, that's not an abuse. That's the way he was looking. I'm just trying to qualify the way he was.
You are pressing him, Abi.
To tell Nigerians the way he was looking, because it's not everybody that has access to TV. For those who didn't see him on TV.
I agree with you.
Now, this one came again. Four of them.
It wasn't tidy. I saw it yesterday.
Into,
I felt
the box. Like,
why didn't they create separate boxes for them?
Like,
they
say common, that they like common criminals.
They were have to because they were charged together.
If they were up to 15 of them, would they have put all of them in that box?
But you should know that the presidency respects that office. I mean, the prosecuting counsel never denied him access to a bail. He said, the Senate President, in respect for that office, he said he's not going to object to his bail, but that so that the legislative business can go on unhindered. He said, but for the Deputy Senate President, who was, I've never seen him in that Akpo chief, very lovely attire.
He said it's a war attire. So I don't know if it's true.
Went to war.
I mean, they are taking this thing to the very pedestrian level. They should take national interest above personal interest and do the needful. Let us say, for once, somebody is able to stand down and say, well, I know I'll come clean. But he just told us that he's ready to go to jail. But I don't think he should.
It's
in black and white.
Are these people not being persecuted?
I believe him.
Well, okay. for me,
a lot of Nigerians feel that they are being persecuted.
I don't see any reason why I should believe that they are being persecuted. As far as what happened yesterday is concerned,
he asked something in his way. How does that arraignment benefit Nigeria as a whole?
He's trying to whip up sentiment by saying the standing order.
How did it benefit Nigerians?
You know, initially what I said was that there was investigation, there was a complaint by a group of people that, look, this is what they did. The police investigated it, and they claimed that their findings show that actually they doctored the rule. And that is a criminal offense. So irrespective of whatever Nigerian...
It was his party members that came up with this, not the presidency.
Whatever Nigerians feel, it doesn't matter. The only thing that can save him is for him to go and prove his innocence in the law court.
He's ready to prove it.
And he has said,
if you discover we didn't have enough of the visual of his arraignment yesterday, because we were told that some senators carried newspapers to block him.
Block people's faces.
To block people's faces, to block the cameras, so that Sumner Sambo's report yesterday, so that we can get clear shots when you check it. Let me quickly take...
Even policemen were beating people.
Okay. Bode is calling us from Osun State. Thank you for joining us, Bode.
Thank you very much. Also, I appreciate you for...
I'm finding it difficult to hear, Bode. Network. Okay, the network is bad.
As the case goes on, we will know whether they are being persecuted or prosecuted. And let me give you an example. When Al Mustafa and the rest of them were first arraigned in front of Justice Adeyemi, their lawyer requested that the judge should allow them to sit down. And the judge flared up and said, how could I allow criminals, to sit in my court? That was the reason why they threw the case away from him. And eventually, that really shut her up. And she's now at the Supreme Court. So in that situation, you can see it has been established that the judge perhaps has made up his mind to jail them. Mm. But look at what the judge said yesterday. He said, I'll be fair to all parties. He has assured Nigeria. So let us see whether he's going to be a man of his word or not.
Senators trying to shield cameramen from taking their shots, and these people, the larger implication, Jide, is that I spoke with a senator last week, and a respected senator, and he told me that the implication is that things will not move forward, especially what has to do with anything that we need to be cleared in the National Assembly, especially that Senate. Thank God they've already done ministers. They've done and budgets and everything. But subsequently, it's like opening the gate of hell.
They have started already. Ambassadorial
lists.
They started work on it, but the moment they were trying to serve them notice of proceedings. I mean, they started dodging.
So, the bigger picture now, Nigerians, how will the trial affect you or anybody as an individual now?
Let me tell you, it's not even about me. It's about the ordinary Nigerians. Mm-hmm. The ordinary Nigerians do not give a damn. And I challenge you, if you do not believe me, let us walk on the streets and be doing interviews. And be asking people.
They are divided, though.
The ordinary Nigerians do not give a damn, and I'm saying it. They know the damage that corruption has done to our country.
They are hungry.
They know the damage that corruption has done to our country. Even this hunger that you are talking about, they believe that it is the byproduct of corruption. So if anybody is put on trial for any form of fraud, you don't expect Nigerians to be shouting on rooftops that, release him, leave him alone. This is not fair. How many times do you hear that happen? How many times? How many times? So the reality is, I've said it before, let the case continue. Because Lazar Akia said that he will be ready to go to jail. What I can say is, be careful what you wish for. Be careful what you wish for. Because the reality is, nobody enjoys jail. I know political leaders who went to jail and after a few years they died. I know those who went to jail and they ran mad. Even our colleague, you remember one of our colleagues?
Yeah.
He went to jail. Abacha jailed him and he came out of prison.
Any jail in Nigeria?
Already, he started having mental problem. That guy is dead now.
Yeah, those who are on medication,
let me tell you, VIPs, which VIP? Governors were VIPs now. during the Second Republic. Yeah. Were they not VIPs? Many of them came out of that prison and
they
died.
We didn't even talk
jail is not something that anybody...
We didn't talk about the deputy senate president. He said this against him is a meticulous trash. The deputy senate president was Kevin, the one who inherited this, as in he's the big winner
okay,
in this.
Let me
match through
meticulous trash. Yeah. Tell me the meaning of meticulous trash. Absolute rubbish. Just speaking off the cuff without conveying any meaning. The idea of trash being meticulous. The idea of trash being meticulous is a stupid one. There's nothing like meticulous trash.
Carefully crafted.
But you said it's trash.
Yes.
So. Put meticulous and trash together. What do you get? It's absolute nonsense that I was saying. I looked at him. I said, this one would think that it made sense. Which sense did it make? People can speak simple English and convey the right meaning. What is meticulous trash? The idea of meticulous trash is a contradiction. The idea of meticulous trash is a contradiction. It's like saying that God can create a stone that he cannot lift.
Man, let's move on. When we return, Ahmed Markoffi has appealed to Alimony Sharif to embrace peace in the party's interest. But will his call make any difference? We'll be right back after this timeout. Stay with us. Yesterday, the People's Democratic Party, PDP, state chairman endorsed the leadership of Markoffi-led National Caretaker Committee and urged Senator Ali Modu Sharif to embrace dialogue and peace. The chairman stated this when a delegation led by the FCT PDP chairman, Yunus Suleiman, paid a solidarity visit to the Markoffi-led group in Abuja. Suleiman said the Markoffi Committee was a product of the National Convention in Port Harcourt in May. He said it was important for the party to work together, as INEC had stated that it required 21 days notice to monitor any primary. This means validly or legally, no primary can be conducted apart from the one which was conducted by and monitored by INEC, as the date scheduled for the runoff of primaries was fast approaching. Has Ali Modu Sharif lost out in Edo State already? MJ, what's... Break this thing down.
Once again, call upon the former chairman, my colleague and friend Senator Ali Modu Sharif, and those associated with him to take the path of dialogue and not to do anything further that will cause, you know, PDP hubs in Edo State. As INEC said, they require 21 days notice before any party can conduct primaries. Even given that we did not conduct primaries, by the time Ali Modu Sharif was talking of conducting primaries, he cannot have 21 days before the closure date for nomination, which means validly, legally, no any primary can be conducted apart from the one which we conducted, which Anne covered.
And I commend Senator Markoffi, our chairman, for his maturity and his team in handling this matter. If nothing else, Sherif was once the National Party chairman of PDP. And so the respect that you accord him is commendable. But I want to appeal to him. No one can be greater than the party. He may have been wronged on moral ground, but by the reason of the constitution of the party, there is a need for him to have a rethink. The lives of many of our people may just be inside this PDP.
Mudu Sherif has ceased to be the chairman of our party since the 21st of May. He has even committed an offense because there is a court order on him not to parade himself as the chairman. The PDP is not a political rascality kind of party. He came from AMPP. He's yet to imbibe the norms, the culture, the attitude of PDP. And he's an interloper, you know, an impostor. He's not and will never. He acted for a short period. And that short period which he acted, he has ceased to be. He's in a dreamland. He's my friend. I've told him, let him go home and take care of his grandchildren.
Boy there, the Chief Olabode George Atanodua, and giving it very hard to Ali Mudu Sherif. And earlier you had Yunus Suleiman, the FCT chairman of the PDP, and Ahmed Omar Kafi. Everybody, break it down, Mujit.
With people like Abode George, I don't think they want peace in that party. You call Mudu Sherif an interloper. You guys were.
That's your chairman.
A former chairman.
Call him a former chairman.
Yeah. In the dreamland.
He says he's living in a dreamland. I should go and take care of his grandchildren. I mean, I think Bode George too is old enough to be grandchildren. He should be nurturing grandchildren. But
great
then,
grandchildren.
Jokes apart now, this party was in that straits. Nobody wanted to take this party. They went to beg him. They knew he had a war chest. Now you brought him. You pushed him aside, you shoved him aside. Now you think he will go
without a fight?
No. You see, but then what McCarthy is doing now is what they should have done from day one. Mm. You can see the gentleman, McCarthy,
yeah.
Former governor, former senator.
Appealing.
I mean, appealing to him. That's what they should have done. But gangsterism or brigandage, the kind of words used by Chief Bode George, cannot work with a sheriff. That's the kind of thing he likes. He would rather that PDP
money for money
loses
anything.
They can't match him. Now you have 24 out of 36 chairmen, and I doubt if they are up to 24. If we do a head count,
they came.
Well, all of them. You see, I said something on this program. I said it's only those 12 states where they have governors that they can vouch of. I mean, if they go to an election today, Sherif will beat them hands down. He will beat any of their candidates. But I think mediation...
because the bigger implication to this is Edo State is September 10.
That is very critical. Because INEC says it's waiting for the court ruling on July 4, which is just next week, to take a decision. Because as it stands today, I think it is Sherif that holds the ace legally. Legally, it is Sherif. McCarthy knows that. But then Sherif too can no longer conduct a primary that will be acceptable to INEC, because INEC needs 21 days notice. But between the deadline,
INEC is giving concession. If you finish your primaries and you need to substitute?
That's substitution. This one is internal wrangling. That is.
It's not even a matter of concession. These things are still subject to court. Actions.
Yeah.
If people they go to court, they can render that
both of primary, the two factions
a nullity.
Nullity.
Mm. So which means INEC will be back to square one.
So
INEC has to really sit down and take the right.
My friend Kennedy Osua on Sunday was saying it on our news that look, if PDP, if they're not careful,
they won't have a candidate.
No,
it has happened before. Mm. This is looking like the Sarumi Agbala Jobi scenario.
of 1992, Abi.
Yeah.
You know?
Okay.
The same thing happened in Kano, which allowed Kabiru Gaya of the National Republican Convention to produce the governor, to become the governor of Kano State. Because SDP, you had Rimi, even Sule Lamido at that time. They were strong, but they had a quarrel with Yaradua because Yaradua was in control of the party structure
nationwide.
Across the nation.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So Yaradua imposed a candidate on them, and they said, no, we'll teach you a lesson because we own this state. Mm. So they made sure that Yaradua's candidate did not emerge. That Shehu Musa Yaradua, that his candidate did not emerge. So they went and voted for NRC. NRC was not strong at all. That's how Kabiru Gaya became governor. He's in the Senate now.
In Lagos, people voted for
Otedola.
NRC.
Yeah.
You know? This is what happens. It also happened, remember, in Kano in 2011.
Yes.
Kwame Nkrumah would not have emerged.
Yes.
The person who would have become governor of Kano State was Mohamed Abacha. Because he brought CPC to Kano.
Yes.
He was funding
very
CPC.
Popular,
he defeated President Buhari's candidate in the governorship primary. He defeated him by a landslide.
Yeah.
That's Lawal Jafaru Issa, who used to be Buhari's ADC. And at one time, he was military administrator of Kaduna State. He defeated him. And you now, at the end of the day, you said no, that you don't want him. He has a baggage, corruption baggage.
Yes.
When they were taking money from him, they didn't say he had baggage. So people were angry.
Concerning the structure.
So they were angry. The CPC overwhelming support of Kano people, CPC had it.
Yeah.
But they decided to go and vote for
Kwankwaso.
It also happened in Katsina State, where the president now, Buhari, decided to go for Aminu Masari instead of the candidate that won the primaries of the CPC.
I remember that.
The people wanted Damarke. Now, they said Damarke had very little education, that it would not be good enough for the state. And they went for the CPC, said, okay, Aminu Bello Masari. The people voted against Buhari. So in two different states, CPC supporters, as much as they like Buhari, they taught him an exemplary political lesson in both Kano and Katsina.
And Katsina
because PDP, they now emerge as the winner of the governorship election in Katsina.
Yeah.
So the point I'm making is, when you have intra-party crisis like this, it benefits your opponent. Ultimately, so it's looking like that what will happen in Edo State. If this matter is not
because Wahid, Sheriff constitutes committee for fresh primaries in Edo State.
Yes,
he has even suspended the PDP
exco
in Edo State. And one other state too in the north. I'm trying to remember now. He suspended.
If you look at what Sheriff is doing, like the proverbial man that cannot milk a cow, like I can use his leg. You know, to scatter whatever you have make from the cow, and I think
bullying the China shop.
And I think the Marukafi group, they are aware of this fact. That's why they are begging him. But unfortunately,
they won't listen to them.
Unfortunately, most of our politicians, they are not good students of history. If not, we have more than enough precedent to show that similar things had happened in the past. And at the end of the day, it is the opposition that benefited from it, but because of their own selfish interest. They will still want to stick to their guns, you know. And I foresee a situation whereby they are not, if care is not taken at the end of the day, they are not going to produce a candidate because of the. And you see, so there will be so many court cases at the end of the day, so many to the extent that, and that will not prevent INEC from going ahead with the election. So at the end of the day, it is the PDP that will lose out. So it is in their own interest to put their house in order and, you know, close rank. Unfortunately, the way Chief Ori just spoke is like seeing that some of them are not even ready for peace.
But this judge in his tiny Lagos state, the smallest state in Nigeria,
not even in control.
But this judge has not been able to unite the PDP in
Lagos
state.
In Lagos state now,
there are three factions.
There's one faction ruled by Musili Obanikoro.
Yes.
another from faction a, now. From what's the name of this Sabado?
Errol Land.
Yes, Errol Land. He has his own faction. He's the chairman of one faction. That's the person that contested for Alimosho Lagos East.
Yeah, in Plateau that nullified the Congress. One of our viewers.
Okay. That's the sheriff nullified a congress that was held
in Plateau State.
In Plateau State. So even in Lagos, Senator Bode George has not been able to show that, look, he's a leader that everybody that can.
No, he can't rally around people. All he does is run his mouth, abuse people thoroughly, and then he trains us how to do politics. No.
Because if you
cannot rally people around
the last election, I was told that he didn't win his polling units.
Of course, he lost his polling units. That was not the first time.
See, why are you talking like this? You expect Bode George to win his polling units in Lagos? The people who want to humiliate him, who are in the APC, they will take a special interest in that polling unit and ensure that it doesn't work. They will mobilize people around there, if only to teach him a lesson. Because when he boasted that he will leave Nigeria, he will go on their side. if Bola Tinubu's party wins at the center, many of his enemies here in Lagos, who had been hoping that one day God will relieve them of Bode George, deliberately worked hard to ensure that that dream.
The thing is, far came
reality. I think so that he goes on exile. So they wanted it to happen. They wanted to see him in their lifetime. They wanted to see Bode George go on exile, and they worked hard for this victory. When this victory came, they waited and waited. The man didn't go on exile.
He
didn't go on exile.
Bode George, moving on now. French humanitarian organization Doctors Without Borders say 8 children are at the risk of dying of hunger-induced ailments every day in Borno State IDP camps. Last week, we talked bitterly about the plight of IDPs in Borno State and called on the federal government to urgently intervene. Today, report says this news has got to the president and is angry at the development. Yesterday, President Muhammadu Buhari met with top officials of the state government seeking explanations. He queried the billions of naira and materials provided by the federal government. Now, federal government, that is the federal government, state government, and non-governmental organizations and private individuals to assist the displaced persons. Are IDPs robbed of the chance to stay alive in Borno State? Jide, this situation is critical. Situation is critical in the sense that I've been seeing disturbing pictures on Facebook. I don't want to believe that's from Borno State.
I was thinking there are live pictures from Borno.
Maybe it's from Somalia or Sudan.
There is no lie about the fact that thousands of people have died and that there is even a cemetery so close to the...
Wow, I see the picture.
Shallow grave.
Yes. The thing is, people are starving. People are starving.
How? With the bags of rice, with the bags of...
But we can now see that not all of the bags of rice that you see...
Get down.
You know, gets to the people who need them. Some other people are stealing this. They are stealing these bags of rice. They are stealing them. This is not... Look, remember the woman... the former body enhancement.
Modupo Zolua.
She went to Goza and some of these communities now. Yeah. I saw pictures of malnourished people in a very bad state that she posted. So it is not, let's not deceive ourselves. They are using shovel to serve rice to people. Let's not deceive ourselves. I told you I've been to IDP camps. When I went to Adamawa State, I went to IDP camp. Those camps are even better than these ones. Because the number of people in the IDP camps in Borno State is extremely difficult to manage.
Because all the local governments...
Because the fighting continues.
Yeah, the local
beyond
governments.
The lies that your military tells you, the fighting continues. They go and come the back, more they fight, and they the don't more people ground. Fight, the more people leave their homes, the more
they
their houses...
They roll to these IDPs.
For example, let me tell you, Did you know that Boko Haram went to the home of Burate's mother and set the village ablaze?
I didn't hear of that.
You will not read about that. You are not likely to read about it, but it happened. So the reality is, and anytime these things happen,
it worsens the refugee problem. People will leave for the refugee IDPs, camps.
Yeah.
So the number is increasing. Unlike in Yobe, for example,
so
where
the
people
officials
are returning.
Will be overwhelmed. Is it that the official over?
They will be overwhelmed. You saw the story that Lara did.
Mm.
An IDP camp in Abuja with only 2 toilets, despite the huge number of people there. So people are in a basket. I even read a story about IDPs being some of the IDPs being given out as slaves. There is a lot of human trafficking happening through those IDPs now.
Who are these daredevil officials of whoever that they will bring bags of rice, bring clothes, bring everything?
It's a Nigerian thing. Corruption, is second nature to us.
No, we discussed this on this program, I think last week, where soldiers and policemen were even quarreling on these relief items that is meant for the IDPs. And also, NEMA's bags of rice were being taken
rebagged
out of the IDPs and rebagged and resold. These are things meant
market.
In the open market.
It's the open market for
yes.
those people that are not.
And you know, rice is very expensive.
Yes. And rice is very, very expensive now. So, you see, it's man's inhumanity to man. It's pure and simple. And but if not for these doctors, these French doctors, I mean, actually.
You wouldn't have known that.
No, we wouldn't have known.
We were dying, seriously.
Medecins Sans Frontières, MSF. So, the Doctors Without Borders.
Mm.
I mean, they went to that place and actually raised an alarm that 24,000 people are in critical need, underfed, out of which about 30 die every day. Out of the 30,
eight
of them are children on a daily basis. So you can, I mean, they raised that alarm and they raised the red flag. If not for them, probably, I mean, they would have been concealing this thing. And this thing is happening right there in Borno, and some people will be telling us stories that
it's part of the federal government efforts, the state government efforts, because that state government will not be telling me that they're building roads. They're building more houses.
No, he says it's the opposition that is sending those pictures. That's what he's saying.
Because
everything is like other governors believe that they must politicize everything.
That's what he's saying.
Everything is now central to Maiduguri because there's no life outside. Again, you can't be building
the
roads.
The problem is
outside.
If we can even, the problem is that Maiduguri is so terribly underreported. Even the military, they won't allow you to move around as much as you want. I was reading that the commander of the operation Lafia Dole, the reports had gotten to him that soldiers were collecting bribe to escort people across communities. You know, a lot of those communities you can't go on your own.
Mm.
You can't go. If you are going to Chibok, for example, you will have to go with police, military escort. You are going to Dambua, you must get military escort. And it's like once a day that they move. So people bribe them, traders bribe them.
To go and do what's there?
No, to go and buy things. They need to trade and all that. But those highways are dangerous.
Okay.
So they are saying now that soldiers are exploiting innocent Nigerians, by taking bribe from them to lead them through dangerous communities. So the Operation Lafia Dole man said, look, this is wrong. We have received the report, but the people should not be afraid to report soldiers so that they can discipline the soldiers.
Look at what Jide is saying now. And look at what is happening in the IDP camps.
It is not corroborating the fact that
we are fantastically corrupt.
It is sad. You know, one of the primary duties of government is to ensure that the life of the citizen and their property are safe. Government failed in that aspect by not being able to curtail the excesses of Boko Haram before it got out of hand, which made those people to now leave their community and they are living in camps. Unfortunately, that shows how callous some people are. If people are in that condition,
and you are still stealing from them,
money has been sent. Food is being provided by so many people, so many international organizations. Where are those things going to? Look at this picture, it's quite pathetic. As if the
gory pictures.
It's very bad. I just hope that the government will get to the bottom of this and find out those who did what and bring them to
and punish them.
They should be punished. It doesn't speak well of our country.
Then Governor Kashim Setima has actually was said to have deployed DSSS and police to go after those people stealing this.
Now, as we speak, 60 children have been moved to ICU of a particular hospital.
Care units.
Yes, and over 400 people have also been moved to another hospital because of their condition. Their condition, as it is now, they cannot live in that in that environment.
I just hope that this something will be done, and the president will maybe have to send people to monitor the IDP camp because
the president has done so well to take care of the welfare of these people. Even his wife has been going from camp to camp.
Yeah, and the wife of the vice president and really the vice president himself.
I'm impressed.
They are always
with
going
the president
to
Borno
State.
Especially in the Northeast,
yes.
The president has caught a very good break. Mm. And he cannot be happy with what is going on here. Now he must do his best to descend on the dangerous people who are inflicting
corruption within the
IDP camps. On these people. He should descend on them and make examples of them. And let Nigerians see clearly that examples have been made of these people. It is when Nigerians begin to see examples made of corrupt people that we will win that corruption war. And corruption is not limited only to the big people. Even
so
the small ones
the
amongst
small
us
ones in IDPs,
also corrupt.
The officials, NEMA officials and co. MJ, the last take on this?
I think, like Jide said, the we should make sure that we win not just the war, but also win the battle by taking care of those in IDP camps.
I can't take you again. Our time is just fast spent, and that's all. Journalist Hangout. Join us tomorrow for another exciting episode of the program. Watch the repeat broadcast tonight at 11. You can also watch Journalist Hangout on YouTube at youtube.com/TVCNewsNigeria. I'm Ayodele Uzubaki. Bye for now. God bless Nigeria.